In the history of the world, a lot of blood has been spilt in the name of religion, and a lot of political conflict has arisen due to religious divisions. So wouldn't the world be a better place if there was just one religion or even no religion at all?
He's echoing what every modern youth is actually thinking. He's echoing this. When I go to schools and we ask the youngsters, now here, how many are theists, meaning believe in God? How many atheists, means don't, there's no God, like Richard Dawkins, and how many are agnostic? We have no clue. This thing is so airy-fairy, we don't know. Majority now in United Kingdom, this is research now, majority fall into the second camp. This is their challenge. They say, it appears to us that religions are not a resolution of human condition, they are the problem. They're not a solution, they are the problem. Best to snuff them all out. Snuff them out. In fact, if you look at the world today, just look at the world today. All the conflict you see around the globe, if you look at the depth, the deeper aspect, it's all religiously oriented. Almost all the conflict, Middle East, wherever you look, always religion seems to be right at the heart of it, everywhere. So religions seem to be the real cause of problem, the real cause of, real issue for humanity. Why don't we snuff them out? Trying to say one will win over the other means you will have more bloodshed. Try and imagine trying to do that. 2 billion Christians, 1 billion Muslims, and God help the rest of us. And they all want to score points, saying, I am right and you are wrong. And you see, this exclusivistic kind of ideology that I am right and you are wrong is itself divisive to a great extent. Do you know how it's divisive? It doesn't stop by saying only Christian. Then within Christian, you say, oh no, but then there is the Catholic and the Protestant. Oh, then there's the Methodist and this and Evangelical. And the whole thing starts, there are 190 denominations in Christianity. So they'll start fighting amongst themselves. It's only that because they've got a common enemy, people of other religion, they've become quiet now. So they're fighting amongst themselves. So what is the resolution? Should we snuff out religions? Is their sell-by date gone? Kick them all out? Think about it. Look, this religion we come from allows us to challenge religion. And say, if it is the case, this Swami Vivekananda, if you feel this become counterproductive, spit it out. We would say that. If you think it's counterproductive, spit it out. You see, the resolution lies this. If you look at the history of mankind, individually, when single religions were visible in certain locality, in the certain kind of periods of history, they were cohesive. That brought about a lot of philanthropic activity. Overall, they were positive because they're talking about learning to live for others and helping others and charity. They were positive. As the world has become a global village, and there are so many conflicting claims to spirituality, they don't sit well together, we have friction in the name of religion. That's what is becoming visible. How will it be resolved? That's what I said in the previous question. The only religion, look, I'm being very arrogant. Let me be arrogant once in a while. The only religion that offers a reconciliation between different worldviews about different religions, different religious worldviews, as well as science-oriented worldview, rationally founded science. The only religion that makes an attempt, not just to say, let's put them together, clutter them together. They don't fit, like nothing fits, but doesn't mean just hold them together. Say, be nice to each other, be nice, don't hit each other. It won't work. You need to fit the jigsaw puzzle and produce a bigger picture, a much cohesive picture, naturally cohesive. And that exercise, and that, if you like, responsibility lies with you. It is your religion that holds that answer of reconciliation. Can you say reconciliation? How can they be reconciled? So vastly different. They talk such different things, like Buddhism, there's no God to start with. How do you can reconcile. And in this century, two things will happen. Look, I'll be very honest. Either this broad idea of Hinduism called pluralism, there are many ways to relate to the idea of spirit, not even call him God. Either this will become very evident now, and used in society to bring natural cohesion and reconciliation, or it will be invoked and we'll be singing the glories of pluralism that is heart of Hinduism in days to come after we become more bloodied. Two options only. You know, I tell this to the Archbishop of Canterbury. I say, you've got two options. Either adopt this Hindu idea of pluralism now and stop bloodshed, or we'll wait. The world will become more bloodied and then you'll be singing the glories of pluralism. You've got two choices, no third choice. And the third choice is all the religions be snuffed out. Let the humanists win. Be open to that. This is the world that we face. And you see why you are so crucial. Provided you understand the depth of Hinduism, you are the carriers, the ambassador of this broad vision. which can bring about natural cohesion. Look, we are not here to score points for Hinduism. We are saying, look, we have this. Use it. Take it away. Don't say it's Hinduism. Take it. Use it. Bring reconciliation. Take it away. We are not selling copyrights. Yours. Incorporate it within your system. Look, when I talk like this to the chaplain of Surrey University, you know what he said after listening to me? Because I really take them to task. I really don't let them off. I'm really rough. They say, Jay, I'm a 70% pluralist. I say, okay, you pass. Don't worry. That's enough for me. I won't rub it in any further. This is happening genuinely all around. I meet so many Christians who relate to pluralism. They say, but you know, our system, the doctrines, they have to be pulled apart because you've been saying exclusivity and you are challenging us, you're making us pull out. I say, if you don't do it, somebody else is going to come and thump you. Let me do a funny story. Once I was dealing with some Christian ministers, this can be broadcast because the Christians don't thump me, that's why. Once I was dealing with some Christian ministers, I said, look, you know, why do you send people to our poor, kind of ignorant people in India and try and convert them? You're creating a rift in our society. You're hurting us, harming us. Why do you want to go and convert, evangelize? Stop it. We've got our own religion. Give them something else. Don't give them religion. They've got it. He said, Jay, he was a nice fellow, you know, nice cozy fellow. No, Jay, we are not trying to convert. We're just spreading the good news. The language they use, we are spreading the good news. You know, Christ is born and Christ died for it. I said, okay, okay. I said, you want to spread the good news? You see, I picked this up from Vivekananda, this lovely stuff. He said, you want to spread the good news? Yes. I said, you know, there is this prophet of Arabia waving his arms frantically, saying that he has got the latest edition of news. And you know what they say about news? All news is no news. So why don't you pick up Islam and change? Oh, gee, we didn't mean like that. But you're talking about news and he's got the latest edition of news. And all news is no news, so your Bible is out. And they shuddered. You see, I'm telling them how exclusivism can never win. Because if I'm here out to kill or convert, there are others who want to do the same to me. If I go out trying to convert others, there are others snapping at my heels to try and convert me at the same time. I've left myself open for attack. You need to remove this exclusivist agenda. Recognize this broad vision of pluralism. That's the way out.